Dear students, in this module, we are going to look at various determinants of adolescent fertility and their sexual behavior. As you are aware, adolescence is a period of key transition in life within a short period of time. Chief among these transitions for many girls are the start of sexual activity, marriage, and childbearing. Concerns about adolescent childbearing include its association with heightened health risks for mothers and their infants, and lower educational attainment and persistent poverty among women who become mothers during early adolescence. Sexual activity at an early age, before girls have adequate information on potential health risks, self-protection skills, or full access to reproductive health services, puts girls at an elevated risk of sexual and reproductive health and childbearing problems. Young women are particularly vulnerable to sexual violence and coerced sex, as cited by United Nations study in 2004. Unintended and unwanted pregnancy and abortion are the main reasons behind the vulnerability. Pregnancy is the leading cause of death for adolescent females in many developing countries, as studied by World Health Organization in 2012. With adolescent mothers twice as likely to die from pregnancy-related complications as mothers aged 20 years and above, as quoted by Conde Ogedo et al. By 2005 and Patton et al. In 2009. Adolescent mothers are more likely to suffer severe complications during delivery, while the children of young mothers have higher levels of morbidity and mortality. Compared to older mothers, adolescent mothers are also less likely to utilize healthcare services before, during, or after delivery, and they are more likely to initiate antenatal care late, deliver outside health service facilities, and rely on an unskilled birth attendant, as studied by Magadi et al. 2007. Young women are particularly more vulnerable to the negative consequences of induced abortion compared to older women. They are more and most likely than older women to present late abortion and to have repeat abortions. It is estimated that worldwide, 3 million girls aged 15 to 19 years old undergo unsafe abortions every year, as per the findings of World Health Organization 2012. Early childbearing is likely to put a young mother on a lifelong path with different choices and opportunities than if she were to postpone her first birth to a later age. She is likely to have more births because of exposure to a longer period of childbearing. Early childbearing may also put a premature end to a young woman's schooling and threaten her economic prospects, earning capacity, and overall well-being. Young mothers may pass on to their children a legacy of poor health, deficient education, and meager means of living, creating a hard-to-break cycle of poverty, as quoted by United Nations in 2004. Studies have also found repetition of early childbearing across generations. Daughters of teenage mothers are more likely than daughters of adult mothers to begin childbearing early. At the population level, recent estimates by the World Bank show that the lifetime opportunity cost of adolescent pregnancy for national economies, measured by the young mother's foregone annual income over her lifetime, range from 1% of gross domestic product, which is also called as GDP in China, to 30% in Uganda, as studied by Chaban and Cunningham in 2011. An early onset of childbearing also results in a young population age structure. Sexual activity at an early age, before girls have adequate information on potential health risks, self-protection skills, or full access to reproductive health services, puts girls at an elevated risk of sexual and reproductive health and childbearing problems. Young women are particularly vulnerable to sexual violence and coerced sex, as studied by United Nations 2004. Unintended and unwanted pregnancy and abortions are also some of the important problems that make adolescent women vulnerable. Pregnancy is the key leading cause of death for adults and females in many developing countries, as quoted by World Health Organization 2012, with adolescent mothers twice as likely to die from pregnancy-related complications as mothers aged 20 years and above, as studied by Conde Agudelo in 2005 and Patton et al. In 2009. Adolescent mothers are more likely to suffer severe complications during delivery, while the children of young mothers have higher levels of morbidity and mortality. Compared to older mothers, adolescent mothers are also less likely to utilize healthcare services before, during, or after delivery, and they are more likely to initiate antenatal care lately, deliver outside health facilities, and also rely on an unskilled birth attendant, as quoted by Magadi et al. 2007. Young women are particularly more vulnerable to the negative consequences of induced abortion compared to the older women. They are more likely than older women to present late for abortions and to have repeat abortions. It is estimated that worldwide 3 million girls aged 15 to 19 years old undergo unsafe abortions every year, as studied by the World Health Organization in 2012. Early childbearing is likely to put a young mother on a lifelong path with different choices and opportunities than if she were to postpone her first birth to a later age. She is likely to have more births because of exposure to a longer period of childbearing. Early childbearing may also put a premature end to a young woman's schooling and threaten her economic prospects, earning capacity, and overall well-being. Young mothers may pass on to their children a legacy of poor health, deficient education, and meager means of living, creating a hard-to-break cycle of poverty, as quoted by United Nations in 2004. Studies have also found repetition of early childbearing across generations. Daughters of teenage mothers are more likely than daughters of adult mothers to bear childbearing early of their age. At the population level, recent estimates by the World Bank show that the lifetime opportunity cost for adults in pregnancy for national economies, measured by the young mother's foregone annual income over her lifetime, ranges from 1% of gross domestic product in China to 30% in Uganda, as studied by Caban and Cunningham in 2011. An early onset of childbearing also results in a young population age structure, a shorter average span between generations, and more rapid population growth due to population momentum than when childbearing is delayed. When successive age cohorts of women begin their childbearing earlier and space their births close together, relatively large cohorts of children enter their reproductive years and bear children. From the family point of view, adolescent fertility represents a family matter. Parents of adolescent mothers are involved in bringing up the baby, which frequently includes co-resistance as well as other direct supports. In such sense, adolescent fertility has direct implications on the family budget as well as on family daily life. Moreover, adolescent fertility has a negative impact on women's condition because it anchors women's life to a reproductive and domestic role, as quoted by United Nations in 1989. As stated by different authors, adolescent fertility has a positive effect on total fertility rate, which is TFR. Women who have their first childbearing during adolescence have between 2 and 3 more children than women who have their first child after 20 years old, as studied by Welty 2005, Wolf and Singh 1991, and Bubinik 1998. Teenage fertility does not only matter because of its adverse effects that, even though are well documented, are not free of criticism, but also because 1. It is higher among poor groups, and 2. As recent data show in Latin American and the Caribbean countries, it is keeping steady and even it is increasing, and 3. New tendencies show independence between fertility, in particular the adolescent one, and union formation, which means that The experience of motherhood is lived in a condition of triple disadvantage of precocious, poor, and in the absence of the partner, rather the father of the children. Now we will focus on determinants of adolescent fertility. The several risk factors of being a teenage mother are varied and complexly interact with each other in a complex manner. These factors can be broadly classified into two groups. First, the proximate determinants, and second, the subjacent factors, which are cultural, environmental, family, and individual factors. It is common knowledge that fertility depends directly on proximate determinants, as mentioned by Bogarts in 1978, but at the same time, these depend on subjacent factors as well. The interaction defines the probability to a teenager mother. In the following figure, the three main proximate determinants considered are the marital status, at the age, at first sexual intercourse, and the use of contraception. It is broadly demonstrated that these three factors determine the core of exposure to the risk of pregnancy, as studied by Bay et al. In 2003. However, not totally, because some other factors such as sterility, abortion, nursing, and sexual practices post-childbirth assistance also affect the risk. Now we will discuss about the union. Union, which is formally marriage as well as informal, free union or cohabitation, represents the primary context where sexuality is practiced, particularly with reproductive purposes, and because of this, it is the context where fertility occurs, especially in developing countries, as quoted by MacDevitt in 1996. Late nuptiality affects directly fertility in reducing fertility, the reproductive lifespan. In fact, if sexuality took place only into the union's framework, the age at marriage would define the beginning of exposure to the risk of getting pregnant. The relationship between the age at first union, women educational attainment, and labor market participation are well documented. Women who get married at older ages have more time to finish their studies, enter into the labor market, and get a worker role, as quoted by Rodriguez in 2005, Green and Merrick in 2005, and Sepal in 2004. Let us focus on understanding sexual behavior of adolescents. The second proximate determinant is related to sexual behavior, which is composed by three main subcomponents. The first belongs to sexual initiation. The earlier the initiation, the longer the exposition to the risk of pregnancy, as quoted by Manlow, 2000. The second component belongs to the frequency of sexual intercourse, an issue on which, generally, there is scarce information. In fact, standard surveys such as DHS in developing countries and FFS in industrialized countries do not record characteristics of sexual life for a long period, but ask about sexuality in enclosed reference periods, that is last week or last month, like that. Because of this, the age at sexual initiation is used to evaluate the preconsciousness of exposition to the risk of pregnancy as well as its intensity. A third component deals with sexual behaviors, especially the ones that reduce the exposure risk, as abstinence during fertile period or puerperium. However, due to their effects, such practices are usually classified together with the third and the most relevant proximate determinant, which is the use of contraception. There is consensus that the use of contraception is the most important factor that explains the strong fertility decrease that took place in the last decade in the world and in the region, particularly in the last 30 years, as studied by Sepal and Sillet 2004, Bulato and Castellin in 2001, and Guzman et al. In 2001. As a matter of fact, a totally efficient use of this resource makes irrelevant the other's proximate determinants, because the fertility regulation would depend mainly and only on contraception's use, so that the exposure to the risk of pregnancy would depend exclusively on the use of contraception. Empirically, it has been proved that sexually active adolescents have, on average, a lower probability to use effective contraceptions compared to adult women, as quoted by Terry and Manlove 2000. This seems to be particularly important in the region, and it is probably one of the factors that explain the resistance of fertility decrease. Additionally, in recent decades, there are signs of reduction in the mean age at first sexual intercourse and an increase in the mean age at marriage, widening the exposure gap not only to teenage pregnancy but also to a single teenager mother, with the negative implications and adverse conditions of this condition. The use of contraception depends on personal will to postpone space or limit fertility, as well as on social acceptance. In this second dimension, different aspects concur, such as the existence of family planning programs or contraceptives market, the knowledge of these by potential users, the individual capability to access these programs or to purchase contraceptive methods, and furthermore, the overcoming of at least two barriers, the biopsychosocial costs and the cultural rejection to contraceptions, as quoted by Cole in 1973. The subjacent variables which affect proximate determinants and define their levels and parameters can be grouped into three spheres: individual, family, and society. Starting from the most general sphere related to socio-cultural and environmental aspects, five elements have been considered: social and moral value guides, laws, media, place of residence, and ethnic group. The influence of socio-cultural and environmental variables is extremely important to teenage fertility, given that these characteristics are not only fundamental in defining sexual, marriage, and reproductive behaviors, but also for the definition of the role of adolescence in society, as cited by Dulanto in 2000. Thus, there are societies where teenage marriage is supported and encouraged, and early fertility is not considered a problem. As a counterpart, in other societies, marriage and reproduction during adolescence are discouraged and generally disapproved, in the marriage case even forbidden up to certain age. Society's values can act through informal channels, uses, customs, practices, and unwritten laws, but they can also act through laws, regulations, norms, and policies. Besides this, a key role is performed by the media, which spread information and knowledge and contribute to define attitudes and values related to sexuality, reproduction, and the auto-perception of youngsters, as brought out by Rogers in 1995. Now we will focus on place of residence and its effect on fertility of adolescents. The place of residence, especially the distinction between urban and rural area, affects the reproductive behaviors. This is due in part to the value differences between the two areas, as the modernization theory suggests more traditional behaviors and hence less propensity to the use of contraception. In part due to material differences, higher poverty levels and low levels of education in rural areas, in part to health service access. As a matter of fact, all the empirical studies in the region within the last 30 years show that adolescent fertility is higher in rural than in urban areas. However, this relation could be modified because urban areas are characterized by two types of messages opposite to each other concerning to adolescent fertility. On one side, they tend to inhibit the early fertility, greater access to family planning services, greater exposure to sexual education messages, and a diffused acceptance of fertility control. On the other side, the secularization process and the exposure to messages that encourage early sexual activity without simultaneously stressing the importance of contraception. Let us discuss about ethnic groups and its relevance to adolescent fertility. Another important socio-economic and demographic characteristic is the ethnic group. Numerous studies such as Sepal 2005 and Manlove et al. 2000, Murray et al. 1999, Yamaguchi and Kendall 1987 show that belonging to ethnic groups or indigenous population has a positive effect on the probability of being a teenage mother even after controlling for socio-economic characteristics. Belonging to indigenous groups affects individual behavior because each group defines sexual and reproductive behavior as well as the role of adolescence in the society. It is worth mentioning that against the generalized image, indigenous culture not always promotes early fertility, promoting sometimes late nuptiality, and since marriage and sexuality happen almost at the same time, this means a lower risk of adolescent fertility, as brought out by Rodriguez in 2003. In relation to family characteristics, the evidence shows that the family in which people are raised affects the reproductive behavior during adolescence, as cited by Late et al. 2001, Hopcraft 2001, Burnett et al. 1991. The family factor operates through various mechanisms. One of them is the family socio-economic conditions during childhood, given that it defines the main steps of the biographic project and the individual construction of the self, as cited by Fischoff et al. In 2001. According to some authors, economic condition is one of the key factors of adolescent fertility, whereas for other researchers, its effects is not as important as other familiar variables as, for instance, parent control, as mentioned by Florence and Nunes 2003, Guzman et al. 2001, Hansom et al. 1987. Other family structure characteristics seem to be highly correlated to teenage pregnancy risks. Girls who grow up in family structures with both parents have a lower probability to get pregnant during adolescence than the ones who grow up in a single parent families or out of their family of origin, as mentioned by Robbins et al. In 1985. This is explained in part because female teenagers who live in single parent families could have more responsibility on brothers and sisters, which could have an effect of rapid socialization to the role of mothers. On the other side, female teenagers who live with only one parent have lower parental control. In literature, there are a lot of studies that evaluate the father-daughter relationship and its effects on the incidence of teenage pregnancy, as per the studies conducted by Lipovsk 2002 and Corcoran in 1999. For instance, the risk of getting pregnant is lower between girls who used to talk with their fathers about sexual matters, as mentioned by Manlev et al. In 2000. Another important element is represented by the intergenerational inheritance, that is, if the mother's girl has been teenage mother. In fact, daughters of teenage mothers have higher probability to have a child at early ages, and this effect persists even if controlling the socio-economic characteristics, as brought out by Hopcraft and Kiernan in 2001, Manlev et al. In 2000. Further, Manlev notes that besides the demonstration effect behind this association, some other channels can also be acting, such as a weaker school trajectory of the daughters of teenage mothers. Now we will discuss about individual factors affecting adolescent fertility. The last indicator affecting female adolescents' reproductive behavior is related to individual factors such as educational level, labor market participation, religiousness, number of desired children, knowledge of contraceptive methods, exposition to media messages, number of partners, self-esteem, and psychological factors. It has been widely demonstrated that there exists a strong relation between women's education level and fertility control. Women with higher education postpone marriage and have lower fertility levels. This is because education reduces the number of desired children, strengthens the option of reproduction control, and decreases children's utility, increasing their costs. Particularly among young females, an increase in education is associated with lower early fertility and reproduction indicators, as studied by Sepal and Oiz 2004, Ali et al. 2003 and Singh 1998, Wolf and Singh 1991, Gupta and Litchi 1999, Manlow 2000. It is worth mentioning that this relationship is bidirectional. Nuptiality during adolescence is a condition that makes the educational process easier. For a correct evaluation of which of the two directions of the relationship predominates, one should control which of the two events, which are school desertion or pregnancy, occurs first. Let us study about labor market participation. Labor market participation has a direct effect on fertility because it increases the opportunity cost for women. Working women are characterized by lower fertility levels than not working ones. However, in the case of adolescents, the relation between labor market participation and fertility is more complex, given that the entrance in the labor market corresponds to entrance in adulthood and consequently a step closer to reproductive life. Thus, the fact of being an income provider can on one side increase pregnancy risk for women who is now projected in her adult role, and on the other side decrease it incomparably between job and children. Recent studies have shown that precocious maternity is associated with school desertion in the short term, which led young women to access labor market, but in the long run it is a factor that inhibits female labor participation, as brought out by Rodriguez in 2005. Other studies on this issue, such as Bivinick 1998, have shown that poor teenager mothers have a greater probability to work and to work more hours at a much lower income than the rich ones. Another outstanding individual factor is religiousness, which defines part of the individual values framework. Individuals' religionness can promote or limit sexual, marital, and reproductive behaviors. Overall, in conclusion, we can say that adolescent fertility depends on the social characteristics. It is therefore important to design a program taking these characteristics, particularly of the most vulnerable girls, that is, the ones who belong to the lowest socioeconomic level, and specific groups as black and mixed adolescents in Brazil, into account. This means to reach girls with programs that consider their culture, history, and values. Considering, for instance, the indigenous population, even though the study and this aspect has been properly taken, it is important to emphasize how, in relation to family planning programs, it is necessary, when possible, to evaluate the differences among indigenous and no indigenous populations, as suggested by Del Popolo and Oirens in 2005. The family planning programs should not propose reproductive goals typical of Western society among indigenous populations. They should assure the right to the access to family planning in the respect of their freedom and their desires, and warrant the right to decide freely and responsibly the number and spacing of children, and also giving the information, education, and all the necessary means to do it. Also, for a better adolescent health, there has to be support through schools, family, and other relevant institutions to girls and boys in their way to self-determination, including the access to the means to exert. Considering the right to have educational and work options to develop their project life. In this case, it is important to give adolescents the key to open the door of all the spheres of social existence, to give them the possibility to decide with path embark on, and do not let them with only one option in life. This process needs higher education levels with higher quality, so that available project girls stop choosing the role of mothers as inescapable choice. Encouraging higher school participation in spreading different behaviors and family models, and knowledge related to family planning programs is also very important in this aspect. The main role of the school is not only its educational and knowledge diffusion activities, but also it's potentially based on bringing information to peer groups, influencing potential partners at the same time. This situation is not done in any other social context. Promoting more equal gender relationships in the attempt to set adolescents, men and women, at the same level with the same possibility to exert power in the couple is also very important. This means providing particularly girls with the tools to be able to negotiate with their partner about the use of contraception without representing it of reason of prejudice. Developing public policies consistent with values and behavioral changes is also a necessary factor. Fighting girl stigmatization based on their sexual behaviors, for example, age at sexual initiation or contraceptive use, are also important aspects to consider in this regard. Thank you.